Hello everyone, welcome back to this series called Finance Current Affairs, where we pick up some important financial topics and we try and discuss them with the help of different questions. So before moving on to question number one, if you are there for the very first time, please do subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon so that you can be notified whenever a new video comes up. You can also join our Telegram group if you want the free PDFs of these sessions. So moving on to question number one then. It says, which of the following correctly states the basic rationale behind swing pricing of debt mutual funds scheme? So recently, SEBI has launched this swing pricing mechanism for our open-ended debt mutual funds. So let us have a bit of discussion about this, then we'll come back to the question and answer it. So if you remember, in the month of July, a consultation paper came up regarding introducing the swing pricing mechanism for mutual funds. So we also discussed that very consultation paper in detail, where I talked about what is swing pricing, how is it going to be applicable on the mutual funds. And now finally SEBI came up with this very framework for the open-ended debt mutual fund. So let us once again discuss what is this swing pricing mechanism and why SEBI is keen to implement it for the mutual funds. So SEBI floated a consultation paper in the month of July that related to the swing pricing framework. After the feedback, with whatever feedback was received, finally the decision has been taken to introduce this framework for open-ended debt mutual funds. So first of all, we must know what are mutual funds, then what are open-ended mutual funds, and then what are debt mutual funds, in order to be able to understand this concept. So mutual funds are a kind of a financial instrument where the money of numerous people is pooled together, and that pooled money is then invested in different instruments like bonds, equity, and other assets. Okay, so mutual fund is a financial vehicle which is made up of pool of money collected from investors, and then it is invested in different securities like stocks, bonds, money market instruments, and other such assets. Now, there can be an open-ended mutual fund or there can be a closed-ended mutual fund. So when there is no fixed maturity, when as per your requirements, you can invest in or enter in a mutual fund, and as per your wish, you can exit or redeem that mutual fund at any point in time, that is an open-ended mutual fund. Whereas when there is a fixed maturity period when you can enter or exit, when fixed time is there to invest or redeem the mutual fund, then that's a closed-ended mutual fund. So here, this mechanism will be applicable to open-ended mutual fund, basically open-ended debt mutual funds. So debt funds are those where this pooled money is invested in various debt instruments, fixed income earning instruments, like there might be some government securities, some bonds, some debentures. So jo paisa investors se ikhatta karke debt instruments mein, jo aapke bonds, debentures wagera hai, unme invest kiya jata hai, wo hote hain aapke debt mutual funds. And when there is no fixed time period when you can enter or exit, then such a mutual fund is an open-ended debt mutual fund. Alright. So moving ahead to this swing pricing mechanism, it will be implemented from 1st of March 2022. So let's first understand what is this swing pricing. Swing pricing is the market's preferred mitigation technique against dilution effects from subscriptions and redemptions. Now a mutual fund is there. Okay, it's the pooled financial instrument where people's money is pooled. So many people invest their money, and that money collected is then invested in other instruments. So many people can subscribe to this mutual fund. There might be people who want to redeem their investments. So when these subscriptions comes up or the redemptions comes up, there are various costs associated. Like the mutual fund manager, the portfolio manager has to invest this in various other securities. Or if people are wanting back their money, then he needs to take them out from those invested securities. So a lot of direct and indirect costs are associated. When people start redeeming their mutual funds, then obviously the value of this fund will fall. Suppose there is a situation, a distressful situation, and people want to redeem their investments. So a lot of people who had invested in their money will ask for their money back. Now, when they are withdrawing their investments from the mutual fund, its value will fall. Value of per unit value of a mutual fund is called the net asset value. It's the value that represents the Net asset value represents the market value per share for a particular mutual fund. That is, it's the price at which you can buy the fund shares from the fund company or sell them if you want to. So if many people start redeeming their investments, then the value of this fund is going to fall. Now, suppose 20 people invested in a mutual fund and 15 of them want to withdraw because there is some distressful situation which is going on. But there are 5 such investors who had a long-term perspective who want to continue their investments with this mutual funds. So because these 15 people are withdrawing their investments, the value of this mutual fund is going to fall, because of which those who want to remain invested are going to suffer. So to prevent this thing, swing pricing mechanism has been introduced, where those who are leaving the mutual fund will have to bear the cost of leaving that, and these people who want to remain invested will be secured, will be protected from losing out because they chose to basically continue their investment with this mutual fund. Okay, so anti-dilution technique hai ye swing pricing mechanism, jo basically jo logo ki wajah se us mutual fund mein nuksan ho raha hai unhi ko uski cost bear karni pade, is pe focus rakhti hai. It's an anti-dilution technique that helps fund manage liquidity risks by passing on the transaction cost to the shareholders who are associated with that. So how this swing pricing mechanism will work? Here, if people are leaving, if they are taking away their investments from the mutual funds and leaving, then the net asset value will be reduced by a certain factor, and they have to get that reduced value because they are leaving from that mutual fund in such a market situation. Let us discuss this with an example. Swing pricing is a mechanism used to ensure that long-term investors in debt schemes are not adversely impacted due to big ticket redemptions by large investors. A huge pool has been created and invested. So this is basically a mutual fund. Now, if large investors start withdrawing a lot of money, then ones who chose to remain invested are going to suffer. So swing pricing mechanism will solve that problem, will protect them. Okay, it will adjust the NAV of a scheme at times when large outflows are happening, so that the redeeming investors, so that there is no erosion in value and the redeeming investors don't get any unfair advantage. जो अपना पैसा withdraw करके चले गए mutual fund ने, से उनको कोई unfair advantage नहीं मिलना चाहिए, उनको नुकसान भरना पड़ेगा क्योंकि उनकी वजह से overall mutual fund की value में कमी आ रही है. So let us discuss this with an example. Suppose there is a mutual fund having value of rupees 100. Its net asset value is 100. Okay, there will be a swing factor. Usually 1-2% minimum rate has been decided, and if we consider that swing factor rate is 1%. So if your withdrawals from your mutual funds, your outflows exceed certain threshold, then this swing pricing will be applicable. Suppose they have set up a threshold of 5%. That is, if you withdraw more than 5% from the mutual funds, then you have to bear the cost of that. Alright, and suppose the swing factor is 1%. Decide kiya gaya ki agar aapne 5% se zyada paisa withdraw kiya mutual fund mein jo aapne invest kiya tha, to aapko kam value pe wo mutual fund chhod ke jana hoga, aapko jo value prevail kar rahi hai wo nahi milegi. And kitni kam value aapko milegi, kitna deduction hoga us net asset value se, the whatever is the rate of the swing factor. So suppose swing factor is 1%. Okay, now the market is not doing well and you decided to withdraw your investment from the mutual fund, and the amount you want to withdraw is more than 5%. So threshold se zyada paisa withdraw karna cha rahe ho, to aap ja rahe ho chhod ke, iski wajah se baakiyon ko na suffer karna pade, isliye aapko kam value pe kam value milegi usi same mutual fund ki jo pehle 100 hua karti thi. So if you would have, so the value was rupees 100, but because now you are exiting, because of which existing ones who are existing in that mutual fund are going to suffer, now you will bear the cost of leaving the market, the mutual fund market. So 1% of this 100 is rupee 1. So now you are going to get 99 rupees when you are exiting. So a net outflow of more than the threshold, if it is there, then you have to bear that cost. And if there might be some people who, despite of the situation, despite of this distressed situation when people are leaving the market, if they decide to enter the market, then they'll get the benefit. That is, they will get a chance to invest in mutual fund at just 99 rupees. So agar distressed scenario mein log mutual fund chhod ke ja rahe hain aur kafi zyada threshold ke beyond paisa withdraw kar rahe hain, to unko wo cost bear karni padegi, jaise ki is case mein 1% hai, तो 99 रुपीज उन्हें मिलेंगे अगर वो म्यूचुअल फंड विड्रॉ करेंगे। और अगर इस सिचुएशन में कोई नया इन्वेस्टर आ रहा है, डिस्ट्रेस सिचुएशन में भी वो पैसा इन्वेस्ट करने को रेडी है, तो उसको कुछ फायदा मिलेगा, उसको 100 रुपए ना देके 99 रुपीज में वो म्यूचुअल फंड मिल जाएगा। सो दिस इज स्विंग प्राइसिंग मैकेनिज्म। नाउ टॉकिंग अबाउट द एप्लीकेबिलिटी ऑफ दिस वेरी फ्रेमवर्क ऑफ स्विंग प्राइसिंग, सो इट विल बी एप्लीकेबल जस्ट ऑन द ओपन एंडेड डेट म्यूचुअल फंड्स, एक्सक्लूडिंग योर ओवरनाइट फंड, योर गिल्ट फंड्स। ओके, तो ओपन एंडेड म्यूचुअल फंड एक्सेप्शंस आर दीज, इनमें ये जो भी फ्रेमवर्क है ये एप्लीकेबल होगा। एंड इट विल बी एप्लीकेबल ओनली फॉर सिनेरियोज रिलेटेड टू नेट आउटफ्लोज फ्रॉम स्कीम। सो जब स्कीम से पैसा विड्रॉ किया जा रहा है उस केस में ये एप्लीकेबल होगा, व्हेन यू आर रिडीमिंग योर मनी विच यू हैव इन्वेस्टेड इन द म्यूचुअल फंड्स। एंड पार्शियल स्विंग विल बी एप्लीकेबल ड्यूरिंग नॉर्मल टाइम्स, बट इफ इट्स अ सिचुएशन ऑफ मार्केट डिसलोकेशन देन mandatorily this pricing mechanism needs to be followed. So market dislocation is when market is off the track, it is into some kind of a stressful situation, apne normal scenario se hat ke market function kar rahi hai, distressed situation, kisi tarah ki stressful situation mein hai market. Okay, next talking about why SEBI wants to introduce this. So as I have already discussed, to protect those investors who continue to remain invested for a longer period in the mutual fund. All right. So to dissuade large or savvy investors from exiting at times of market panic, thereby preventing the collapse in NAV is the very basic objective. अब कोई स्ट्रेसफुल सिचुएशन हो, पैनिक वाली सिचुएशन हो, उसमें म्यूचुअल फंड छोड़ के ना जाए, बड़े बड़े इन्वेस्टर्स अपना खूब सारा पैसा विड्रॉ ना करें, नेट असेट वैल्यू में फॉल ना आए, ये बेसिक ऑब्जेक्टिव है इस स्विंग प्राइसिंग का। बिकॉज व्हेन लार्ज आउटफ्लोज हैपन देन द फंड मैनेजर इज फोर्स टू सेल गुड क्वालिटी लिक्विड पेपर्स इन ऑर्डर टू बी एबल टू मीट दीज रिडेम्पशंस। And when he is doing so, the investors who are continuing to stay with that mutual fund, they have to bear the brunt. Okay, so जो भी नुकसान होता है वो already existing investors जो नहीं छोड़ के जा रहे उनको ना उनको bear करना पड़ता था, उन्हें ना bear करना पड़े, इसलिए ये mechanism introduce हो रहा है। Alright, so moving ahead now, swing pricing mechanism as far as for normal times is concerned, then the Association of Mutual Fund of India, it will prescribe the parameters to determine the threshold for swing pricing. That if this beyond this much amount, if you are withdrawing the money, okay, then swing pricing will be applicable. At what rate, what will be the swing factor rate? So all that will be decided by the All India Mutual Fund Association, and it can also be decided by the asset management company. Okay, it can have its own parameters for nature and based on the nature and characteristics of the mutual fund. But if we talk about the market dislocation kind of a situation, then in that case the All India Mutual Fund Association, the All India that very association will set up the guidelines, parameters, and it will recommend them to SEBI. Okay, and then SEBI on its own, that is on suo motu basis, on the basis of AMFI's recommendation, it will make it mandatory to follow this mechanism during a dislocated market time period. Okay, so jab market dislocated hai, jab wo proper routine jaise function karti hai waise nahi kar rahi, to AMFI ki guideline ke basis pe ya apni marzi se SEBI decide karega ki ye swing pricing mechanism itne rate pe applicable hoga. So this was about the swing pricing mechanism. The minimum rate which has been decided is 1-2%. The market regulator announced a swing factor in range of 1-2% that will be applicable during market dislocation. Okay, and how all this will happen? The value of NAV will be adjusted for amount which you are withdrawing. Then they have specified different categories. So C3 is the category which has the maximum risk. So for that a minimum of 2% swing will be applicable, यानी कि minimum 2% NAV की में value कम करनी पड़ेगी उन investors के लिए जो market छोड़ के जा रहे हैं. And there is a relief for small investors as well because an exemption of 2 lakhs is given. चाहे normal times है, चाहे dislocated market है, 2 lakh तक का amount exempted है. Okay, so ये एक exemption दी गई है small investors के लिए. Now coming back to our question, we had to identify the basic rationale behind swing pricing. So we have understood that it is to ensure that long-term investors are not impacted during big ticket redemptions from other investors. So option A is correct. Now, moving to second question, which is also related to this mechanism only. SEBI has recently introduced the swing pricing mechanism to protect mutual fund investors. We have to identify these statements which are incorrectly related. So first is correctly related, which says that the objective is to prevent the collapse in NAV when investors are basically exiting. So this is correct. Second is incorrect because it says it's applicable to open-ended mutual fund, including overnight and gilt fund. No, they were the exemptions. So this is incorrect. Third is also incorrect because the relief allowed is just 2 lakh, not 5 lakh. So incorrect statements are second and third. That's why answer is option D. Now coming to next question and next topic of the day. So it says that fintech or technology that provides digital financial services is transforming the provision and delivery of financial services. Digital technology is changing the way the financial services are organized and the financial products are delivered. Identify the benefits it offers. So they are talking about fintech, about digital technology which we are using while rendering the financial services. Obviously, it has a lot of benefits. So if we try and answer this question, it's a very simple question. Usually we can have a kind of a descriptive question on this, that how is the fintech industry doing in India, or how is digital technology changing the way we render the financial service. So a descriptive question can be there. I'll be discussing a recent speech where our deputy governor talked about this thing, and you can pick up some points from there to write your descriptive answer. But just, this is a very simple MCQ based question. So let's read the options. What can be the possible benefits of fintech? Technology ka use karne mein, financial services render karne mein, hume kya kya benefit mil sakte hain? First one says increases the processing speed, that can reduce cost and time for our transactions. Obviously, humne dekha hai ki bahut jaldi se hum mobiles ka use karke logo ko transfer kar sakte hain paisa. We can easily act in a speedily manner, make transfers using UPI and all. So obviously the speed increases because of use of technology, which saves a lot of cost as well as time. So this will be a benefit. Second says it enables communication speed that enhances connectivity, expanding the reach. Now we can easily transfer money to person sitting at a very far away location. Okay, more and more people can easily use the services. They don't have to visit the bank using the mobiles, using the technology. They can easily and in a speedily manner make all these transactions. So this is also going to be a benefit of fintech. Then supporting bank in improving efficiency and reach of financial system. Obviously, it's going to support the banks. If banks are not able to be present everywhere, okay, if people are not able to visit bank for each and everything, they can use the digital services provided by these banks. Fintech firms which excel in technology can support the banks in rendering these financial services. So this is again a benefit. Obviously, it's going to promote financial inclusion. Zyada se zyada logo tak kam se kam cost mein ye financial services pahunchayenge. They will make sure that the financial services reach to more number of people at the lowest possible cost. So this is going to be a benefit. So all of these are the benefits of fintech or use of digital technology in financial service. So answer is option E, all of the above. Now, as I told you, there was a speech uploaded on the RBI website by our Deputy Governor Shri T. Ravi Shankar on responsible digital innovation. What's the role of digital technology in rendering financial services? How is fintech helpful? What is the India's experience related to fintech? He talked about all these things in this very speech. So inki is speech se aap kahi aise acche points utha sakte ho ki fintech ka kya status hai India mein, क्या बेनिफिट्स हैं जो ये हमें प्रोवाइड कर रहा है, एंड ये पॉइंट्स आपके लिए डिस्क्रिप्टिव क्वेश्चंस में काफ़ी हेल्पफुल हो सकते हैं. कोई ऐसा क्वेश्चन आता है लाइक डिजिटल टेक्नोलॉजी इज चेंजिंग द वे द फाइनेंशियल सर्विसेज आर ऑर्गेनाइज एंड फाइनेंशियल प्रोडक्ट्स आर डिलीवर्ड, कमेंट. सो आपको कुछ पॉइंट्स पता होने चाहिए. सो यू कैन पिक अप दोज पॉइंट्स फ्रॉम हेयर. सो लेट्स डिस्कस देम वन बाय वन. एट द मोस्ट बेसिक लेवल, डिजिटल टेक्नोलॉजी इनेबल्स स्पीड, स्पीड इन प्रोसेसिंग इन्फॉर्मेशन एंड स्पीड इन कम्युनिकेशन. सो जल्दी से हमारे ट्रांजैक्शंस होते हैं, ठीक है, ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा लोगों तक वो ट्रांजैक्शंस, वो फैसिलिटीज पहुंच पा रही हैं. ये सब टेक्नोलॉजी की वजह से हुआ है. प्रोसेसिंग स्पीड हैज़ रिड्यूस द कॉस्ट एंड टाइम फॉर ट्रांजैक्शंस. विद इन अ स्पैन ऑफ फ्यू सेकेंड्स वी कैन ट्रांसफर मनी. ओके, वी डोंट नीड मच टाइम, वी डोंट नीड टू विजिट अ बैंक ब्रांच टू डू सच ट्रांजैक्शंस. सो कॉस्ट, टाइम इज सेव्ड. एंड the connectivity of systems expand the reach of transactions. More and more people can access it. okay, they, if there is there's no bank branch available, but you have the internet available, you can make such transactions. You have the digital options available, you can make such transactions. So reach has expanded because of technology. Secondly, digital innovation has enabled fast payment systems like UPI, IMPS. Now just we need a phone number or the UPI address of the person, and we can easily, with a click of a mouse or within a span of few seconds using mobile, we can easily transfer the money. Instant communication and ability to process large databases, use of Aadhaar for transaction authentication has made it easy for government transfers into bank accounts of beneficiaries. Now government runs various schemes, it needs to provide subsidies, it needs to provide the beneficiaries with certain benefits where the amount need to be transferred directly to the bank account. So now using the technology, that is possible. Are you aware about the Jam Trinity, which is Jan Dhan accounts, Aadhaar based authentication and the usage of the mobiles? So using all this, the directly the money can be transferred to the bank account of the beneficiaries, and authentication can be done using Aadhaar. So that is the benefit which this technology is bringing, that we can directly transfer the money to the beneficiary's account within a span of few seconds using the technology which we have. eKYC has contributed to the safety of online payments. When you are going online, when you are going digital, obviously there are chances of cybercrime, there are chances that the person is not giving a true information, correct information, the person is a fraud person. So we need to be verify their identity. eKYC can be used. We can go for tokenization, where the information can be converted into code language so that the information is not misused. So technology, if it is bringing some positives, it is also having some limitations. But alongside those limitations, it's also coming up with the solutions for the same. Agar koi problems aaye technology ki waise, to usko solve karne ke solutions bhi us technology ne hi hame diye hain. P2P lending, crowdfunding are gaining popularity in substituting bank credit. Now we have the apps, we have platforms where people can borrow and lend among themselves. So it's going to give us support to the bank credit. We don't just need to rely on the banks to provide credit. We have other platforms as well because of the technology. This has been possible. Technology such as artificial intelligence, machine learning has been used in areas of investment advice, fraud detection, help desk. So because of technology, new areas are emerging. It has become easy to get an investment advice, to detect the frauds. All right. So the technology is giving us the benefit that it is improving the efficiency, the way we are doing things. We are able to utilize resources in more better manner, do the things at lower possible cost, in lower possible time. Then it is expanding the reach of financial system. ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा लोगों तक हम financial service पहुँचा पा रहे हैं क्योंकि हमारे पास technology better आ गई है. All this contributes to economic growth as well as financial inclusion. Moving ahead now, when we are moving towards financial technology, okay, it brings with itself various risks. So there is a need to regulate this fintech industry as well. जैसे हम banks को regulate कर रहे हैं, like we are regulating the banks, we need to regulate these technological firms which are rendering financial services as well. The limitations of technology prepares us to better manage the change that fintech is causing. It's important to regulate them. There are cybersecurity risks, systemic risk, operational risk, risks affecting the competition. So we need to regulate this fintech industry as well. हमें अच्छे rules regulations लाने हैं ताकि हम technology का use करें financial services render करने में, लेकिन information protected रहे, जो भी cybersecurity risks हैं वो सब manage हो सके. Talking about the India's experience with fintech, so Reserve Bank has been creating an environment where digital innovation can thrive. So Reserve Bank is supporting a lot this digital innovation in the field of financial services. We have regulatory sandbox in place, we have innovation hub which encourages the innovations in the field of technology. So RBI has been framing the rules and regulations in such a manner that this fintech industry also gets a boost. Or these banks also start adopting these digital platforms to be able to provide financial service to more and more number of people. Zyada logo tak financial service kam cost pe pahunch paye, is wajah se RBI bhi kafi support kar raha hai digital technology ka use financial service render karne mein. The basic thing which is required is to set up some infrastructure entities. So we have the NPCI, we have the Institute for Development and Research in Banking Technology, NPCI and all, they come up with various systems, UPI and all kind of thing, okay, to support the usage of technology in the rendering of financial services. Then regulation sought actively to facilitate wider participation to include non-banks as well, increase interoperability among different payment systems. So RBI is keen to ensure interoperability between different systems, aapas mein banks, non-banks ke beech linkages ho. Like if you are making payment using a Paytm wallet, obviously it's connected to your bank. So being a fintech, being a part of a fintech industry, Paytm has linkages with the banks as well. Being a non-bank, it has a linkage with bank. So this shows interoperability and RBI is supporting it to make sure that financial services reach to the people at the best possible cost. ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा लोगों तक services पहुँचाने के लिए RBI is willing कि banks, non-banks के साथ function कर सकते हैं, interoperability हो सकती है. The ideal approach is for fintech companies to be considered as enablers and partners by banks than competition. Competition comes when other banks are leveraging fintech better than you. So, आपको fintech को fintech जो firms हैं जो technology का use कर रही हैं भले ही वो banks नहीं हैं उनको अपना competition नहीं देखना. आप उनके साथ collaborate कर सकते हो ताकि वो आपको technology provide करें. Banks के लिए competition ये fintechs नहीं है. Banks के लिए competition बाकी banks हैं जो technology adopt कर रहे हैं जो fintech firms के साथ collaborate कर रहे हैं ताकि वो financial services लोगों तक पहुंचा सके. जो bank adapt नहीं करेंगे technology के साथ ट्रेडिशनल कन्वेंशनल वे में ही फंक्शन करते रह जाएंगे वो पीछे रह जाएंगे और जो फिनटेक फर्म्स का कोलैबोरेट करके इम्प्रूव कर जाएंगे टेक्नोलॉजी में वो सक्सेस पाएंगे. ओके सो बैंक्स कैन कोलैब बैंक्स इनफैक्ट आर कोलैबोरेटिंग विद डिफरेंट फिनटेक कंपनीज सो दैट दे कैन लीवरेज देयर टेक्नोलॉजिकल एक्सपर्टाइज एंड यूज देम व्हाइल रेंडरिंग देयर बैंकिंग सर्विसेज. पॉपुलर Participation is created through making transactions simple, convenient, keeping costs low, minimizing risks. These are all the basic objectives of technology. They help us in making the things more simple, convenient, make sure that costs are low, make sure that the risks can be minimized. Customer data protection is also ensured using tokenization. So we had a discussion on tokenization back few days back where we talked about that how your information which you are providing, your card information, your basic detail is converted into code language which is called tokenization so that that data is not misused. All these steps have been taken if we talk about India. RBI is also shifting its regulatory attention to next level reforms. They are upscaling RTGS, NEFT. They are enhancing their availability to the non-banks. These are made 24/7. So these changes have been possible because of technology. There are other development initiatives as well, like you can online settle your disputes and digital ombudsman scheme, customer complaints, everything can be handled online. This is possible because of technology. Easily, in a very short span of time, you can get your issues redressed. To foster innovation, RBI came up with regulatory sandbox. So new innovations, new initiatives are encouraged. Innovations in the field of financial technology are encouraged. Before launching the things in the market, you test them to make sure that they will later on be successful. Reserve Bank has set up the innovation hub, which is an ecosystem where academics, technology, finance, regulators are brought together. So it promotes innovation in the field of financial sector. Then, as I discussed about Jam Trinity, that with Aadhaar helping in direct biometric identification of disadvantaged citizens, Jan Dhan bank accounts and mobile phones allow direct transfer of funds into their accounts without any intermediaries. जब बीच में intermediaries आ जाते हैं तो corruption होता है, वो पैसे का misuse करते हैं. अब Jan Dhan योजना आधार मोबाइल के बेसिस पे आधार के बेसिस पे verification होगा और directly आप transfer कर सकते हो पैसा उनके accounts में. Small business vendors have started adapting digital payments. So you would have seen that in India, even if we go to buy some fruits, vegetables from the grocers, we are able to get the options like making a payment using a Paytm. We are traveling in an auto and we are having the option to pay using Google Pay. So this shows that small business vendors have started adapting this digital technology. But still we are far behind because this prevails more in urban and rural areas. We have still not been able to penetrate in the unbanked sections where people even lack a smartphone. So hum kafi aage aa chuke hain, ab hume thoda aur aage aur jana hai. While digital payments have become instantaneous within the country, the cross-border payments are still an issue. हमें cross-border payment option financial system को भी और strong बनाना है. There are problems like different exchange rates, time zone differences, regulatory legal requirements. So fintech can surely solve these frictions. आने वाले future में हम देखेंगे कि fintech हमारी ये issues भी solve कर देगा. So to conclude with, we are in best of times. We are doing very good when it comes to fintech. okay, we are having good efficiency gains, customers are satisfied, we are focusing on providing more better experience to the customers, we are ensuring great social welfare, but still we have lots of issues which we have to deal with. Abhi bhi hame thoda aur improve karna hai when it comes to online frauds, compromising the customer credentials, data privacy, safety. Itna kuch hone ke bawajood bhi ye issues aa rahe hain, hame aane wale time pe inko bhi address aur acche se karna hoga. So these were few points which can help you with any of your descriptive answers. Now moving to last question, identify the bank that has decided to close down its ATMs, giving the customers the option to use their debit cards on ATMs of other banks, becoming first domestic lender to completely do away with such machines. So one of these small finance banks has decided that it will close all its ATMs because many customers were not using its ATMs and it had to incur a lot of cost on these ATMs. It was not at all profitable. So the bank has decided that now it will close its ATMs, and whosoever has a card of that bank and need to get the ATM services, they can go to some other bank's ATM and use this card there. So if they are planning to make around 5 to 7 transactions free for their customers. So the answer to this question is option C, Suryoday Small Finance Banks. It has decided to close its 26 ATMs which it has, and it is also planning that 5 to 7 transactions it will make free for its customers who will access the card using other bank ATMs. And it has done so, why? Because they were not able to realize good profits from running these ATMs. It was not at all profitable, and now they will in fact use this money which they were wasting in the ATMs in strengthening their doorstep banking, digital offering and business correspondent network. So unko yahan se nuksan ho raha tha, wo paisa wo kahi aur better areas mein laga payenge. So this was all for today's session. I hope this session was useful for you. With this I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.